there's no heaven.
In Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, it says that the number 7 is the most magical number. Of course, J.K. Rowling was not the first one to say that. Today, we're in the journey of understanding better Shnat Shmita, the 7th year, the sabbatical year. We will explore the number 7. Hello, my name is Dalia Marx. I'm a rabbi and professor here at Hebrew Union College, Jewish Institute of Religion. I am a professor of liturgy, and this is our Jerusalem campus. A lot of people have special feeling about the number 7, but why actually? Today we will try to explore the number 7 in the context of Shnat Shmita, sabbatical year, but in general also in the Jewish culture, but also in the human culture. So in the Torah we see the requirement of counting 7th year, and then it says v'hashvi'it tishmetena unetashta, in the 7th year you shall let it, that is to say the land, rest and lie fallow. In Leviticus we read that the land itself should observe the Shabbat. Yeah, the land shall observe the Shabbat of the Eternal. V'shavta ha'aretz Shabbat le'Adonai. In Deuteronomy, they also talk about Shemitah. And here we talk not only about letting the land rest, but also that every creditor shall remit the due that he claims from his fellow human being. So the number 7 appears a lot of times in the Hebrew Bible. Let's take just a few examples. So we have the 7 days of creation, of course. And then in the book of Mishle, it says, Chachmot banta veita chatzva amudea shiva. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her 7 pillars. Of course, it can be translated in more than one way. But the commentators were interested, what are the 7 pillars? And Rashi, based on the Midrash, says, the 7 pillars are the 7 days of creation. But then he brings another explanation. This refers to the 7 books of Torah. Wait a second, 7 books of Torah? I know of 5. And he says that the sentence, Vayhi bin Soa Aaron, yeah, which is Numbers chapter 10, verses 35-36, is an individual book within the book of Torah. So everything that came before it in Numbers is a single book. These 2 verses are a book, and the book of Deuteronomy is another book. That's why we have 7 books of Torah. Then Noah. The number 7 appears quite a few times in the story of Noah. First of all, he brought to the ark with him 7 items, 7 male items, 7 female items of every pure animal. And then when he sent the dove to see if the water is loosening, it says that the dove could not find a resting place. He waited for 7 days, and then he resent her, and then he waited for another 7 days. When he went out of the ark, he has a covenant with God. It's called the Rainbow Covenant. And the rainbow itself has 7 colors. And Chazal, our sages, are teaching us about Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach, the mitzvot, the commandments that all the nations are bound to comply with. For example, not to murder. This is not a Jewish thing. And there's a joke of Hebrew teachers. How can you write the word Noah with 7 mistakes? You know, the word Noah has only 2 letters. Let's move on. We have the 7 branches of the menorah in the tabernacle and then in the temple. We have the 7 species in which the land of Israel was blessed. We read about them in Deuteronomy chapter 8. But even the 4 species that we take on Sukkot, that we observe on the festival of Sukkot, they are also, you can count 7 in them, because you have 1 etrog, you have 1 palm branch, you have 2 willows, shtei aravot, and you have 3 branches of hadas, of myrtle. So altogether, these are 7. So here again, we have the number 7. And we have 7 that represents completion. Something that is total, something that is whole. We hear about Joshua when trying to conquer Jericho. He went around it for 7 times in 7 days. And he had 7 Kohanim, 7 priests, blowing 7 horns. And we have the 7 gates in the temple. And we have the 7 aliyot for the Torah on Shabbat. And we have the 7 blessings in the Amidah for Shabbat and festivals. And there are so many more examples. And in the nations of the world, also, we have the 7 seas. I travel the world in the 7 seas. Everybody's looking for something. We have the 7 continents. We have the 7 visible planets. We have the 7 major deities in the Babylonian world, and the number 7 is very central in the Babylonian mythology. And we have the 7 scale in the Western musical scale. And we have the 7 wonders of the world. And we have the 7 chakras in the human body. And in Christianity, we have the 7 deadly sins and the 7 virtues and so much more. Let us zoom into 7 in time, 7 in Jewish time. But before that, let's talk for a moment about the 7 lower Sfirot. As you know, the tree of Sfirot has 10 different emanations, 10 different aspects of God. This is not a time to explain the tree of Sfirot, but it has 10 separate aspects of the divine. The 3 upper ones are beyond human capacity. They are beyond our understanding. But the 7 lower ones are often compared to many things. So, for example, on Sukkot, we have the 7 ushpizin, the 7 heavenly guests. Each guest is represented by one of the Sfirot. We have Avraham, who is represented by the Sfira of Chesed, grace. We have Isaac, who's represented in the Sfira of Gvura, that is to say, might. We have Jacob, who's Tiferet, splendor, and so on. Yes, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Aaron, and David. And there are some differences between the Ashkenazic order and the Sephardic, but the names are the same. And today, a lot of us are asking, yes, the Ushpizin, who are represented in the 7 lower Sfirot, but what about the Ushpizot? Do we need to have female, feminine characters represented by the tree of Sfirot, the tree of life? Let us talk about counting by 7. So we have the 7 days of Pesach, and we have the 7 days of Sukkot. Actually, we have 7 plus 1 because the 8th day represents something that transcends nature. If 7 represents the 7 days of creation, the wholeness of what happens in the world, then the 8th day is beyond it. But that belongs to a different session. And we have the 7 days of Simchat HaKlulot, of the joy of a young couple, of a bride and groom. And we have the 7 blessings under the chuppah. And we also have, on the other side of the scale, the Shiva, the 7 days of mourning. And we have the 7 mourners, father, mother, sister, brother, son, daughter, and a spouse. And if we're talking about counting in time, let's talk about counting of 7 times 7. We already mentioned the Jubilee year, the Yovel, which is 7 times Shmitot, 7 times sabbatical years. But we also have the counting of the Omer, which we find in Leviticus 23. You shall count off the day after the Sabbath, which is a big discussion. What actually is this day? Is it the Sunday after Shabbat, as the sectarian sects understood it, or the day after Pesach? But this is not our topic right now. But you should count Sheva Shavatot Mimot. Yeah, we have to count 7 weeks. From the day from Pesach all the way to the festival that we call Shavuot, from the harvest of barley to the harvest of wheat. And the counting of the Omer, which is 7 times 7, is often represented in what is called the Omer calendar, Yomana Omer, where you have 7 days of the week and 7 weeks, and each day of the week is represented by one of the 7 lower Sfirot that we just saw, and each week is also represented by one of the Sfirot. So apparently you have a unique combination of 2 Sfirot for each day of the 40 days of the counting of the Omer. Yeah, the map that you see before you is taken from my book, Bazman, About Time, that was recently published in German and soon in Spanish, and hopefully soon enough in English too. So you can see that each day of the counting of the Omer is represented by a unique combination of two sfirot, two heavenly sfirot, emanations of God. But actually there are more counting of 7 weeks. So for example, in the sectarian book, the Temple Scroll, that belongs to the apocryphal books, it was composed in the Second Temple time. We see that not only you have a counting from Pesach to Shavuot, from the festival of the new barley to the festival of the new wheat, but you also have 7 weeks from Shavuot to another festival that we don't celebrate anymore, but it is documented there, and that's the feast of the first fruit of the wine. That's Bikurei Tirosh. And 7 weeks after that, once again, a counting of 7 weeks, 7 times 7, you have the festival of the new oil, the Chag Bikurei Yitzhar. They are not celebrated anymore, as we said, but just a few decades ago, when the Jews from Ethiopia, the Kehilat Beta Israel, came to Israel, they brought to our attention a new festival, well, new to us, not new to them, a sacred day that they celebrated and continue to celebrate now here in Israel, which is called the Sigd. This is the festival of the renewal of the covenant, and the Sigd is celebrated exactly 7 weeks after Yom Kippur. So if Yom Kippur is a celebration of personal atonement, the Sigd is considered a festival for communal atonement and also a day that the Jews renew the covenant with God and express their longings and yearnings to come to Israel. So once again, you have a counting of 7 times 7. But here's the question. Why 7? What's so special about the number 7? And why Dafka 7? There are so many interesting numbers. And 7 is not an intuitive number. You don't have 7, you could say maybe 5 because we have 5 fingers, or 10 because we have 10 fingers. You can think about the lunar cycle, which is 29 point something. You can think about the solar counting of the days of the year. But what about 7? Why 7 is so interesting and so prominent in our culture and also in other cultures? Let me provide you with 7 reasons, 7 possible explanations for that. Some of them are based on linguistic issues, some of them on philosophical understanding, some of them are cosmological, some of them are psychological, some of them have to do with our physical anatomy or our cognitive perception. I'm not sure that each one of these explanations will convince you, but maybe the accumulation of this explanation can provide us with some better understanding of why the number 7, and please contact me if you think of another reason. So the first explanation is that the word Sheva is closely related to the word Shvua. Sheva, 7, Shvua, oath, and often we see that Sheva and Shvua are related. So, for example, the establishment of the town of Be'er Sheva by Abraham. A lot of people ask, why Be'er Sheva? Does it have to do with the Shvuah that Abraham and the local king of Imelech took? Or does it have to do something with the number 7? If we go to that chapter in Genesis 21, you can see that the word Hishava, Eshava, Nishbe'u appears at least 3 times in the text. Yes, so Abraham swears and Avimelech swears, but the swearing has to do with the 7 hues, the 7 sheep that represent the Shavuah. So 7 is something that in a way transcends the counting by itself. It's something that it goes beyond nature. The Shavuah is not a normal kind of speech between individuals, but it has some sort of sacred nature. And the sacred nature is represented in the name, in the number 7. So that's one explanation. The second explanation goes back to Philo of Alexandria. Philo was a Jewish philosopher who was active in the first century Common Era. And he based his understanding on Hellenistic understanding of the number 6. According to him, the number six is a number of doing. Yeah, 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals 6. 1 times 2 times 3 equals 6. So 6 is about doing, but 7, 6 plus 1, is it has to do with something that goes beyond the doing. Yeah, the world was created, the act of creation was in 6 days, and on the seventh day, that's the day of rest and hinafashi, of celebrating the creation with rest. That's the second explanation. The third explanation of the seven explanation of why seven cites the teaching of HaMaharal of Prague, Rabbi Yehuda Leva, son of Bezalel, Ben Bezalel. He was active in Prague in the 16th and 17th century, and here in the picture you see him creating the golem, which is maybe the most well-known and famous story that is related to him. HaMaharal used to say that everything that has to do with nature comes in the number seven. So you have the seven visible planets, and you have the 7 days of the week, and you have the seven types of metal, and you have the seven directions in nature. So how come we talk about the seven directions? I can think of four directions, right? North, east, south, west, right? These are the four points of compass. We can add to that up and down. So that leads us to six. What is the seventh one? The Maharal says that the seventh direction, the Kivun HaShvi'i, represents everything that is between all the other six. In a way, the number seven, just as Shabbat is everything that is Shabbat is the infrastructure of everything, the space of seven, or the direction of seven, is something that is everything between the different six directions, the four corners of the earth, up and down. We said that the number seven is not so much, you cannot really see it in nature, but the fourth explanation does suggest that we may see it in nature. So here you have a really cool image of the phases of the moon. And if you think about the four main phases of the moon, so from the first, the new moon, the appearance of the moon until it's full, we have about 2 weeks. And then two more weeks until we get the next new moon. The cycle of the moon is about 29 point something days. So if you divide it into half until you get a full moon, that's about 2 weeks, a little bit more than 2 weeks. And if you divide it again by the first and the third quarters, where you have when only the half moon is visible, you can see it in the picture here. It makes it more clear. Then it gives you something that is very similar to seven days. So in a way, the number seven does exist in the lunar system. I move on to the fifth explanation, the number five of explanation that has to do with the five fingers of our hands. Well, coincidence, I didn't plan it this way, but hey. So the number seven is the only prime number, mispar rishoni, prime number between five, that is one hand, and 10, that is two hands. And also, and this is something that I learned from Rabbi Daniel Burstein, this is how the ancient one used to count. So they use their hand, they use the agudal, the fat fingers, to count, and you have four fingers and three joints in each one of the fingers. So three and four gives you seven, but three times four gives you 12, and he says that according to the Pythagorean system, a lot of the ancient calculations had to do with 7 and 12 and everything that comes between them. So here you have something that has to do with our own physicality, if you want to call it this way, but another explanation that has to do with our human body, and that has to do with our face. So some commentators or scholars acknowledge the fact that we have seven openings in our face. We have two eyes, we have two ears, we have two nostrils, and we have a mouth. These are seven openings, and maybe these seven openings of what you see when you look at a person, this is what stands at the core of the number seven and its importance. And the last explanation has to do with psychology, the magical number 7. The cognitive psychologist George Armitage Miller from the psychology department in Princeton published a very influential essay in the 50s, speaking about this magical number, 7, saying that in our working memory, or in our short-term memory, most people can hold in their memory, in their short-term memory, 7 items. And he says 7 plus 2 minus 2. So it's between 7 and 9, and the magical number is 7. This is what we can carry with us without in our short-term memory. Of course, later there are all kinds of new essays that challenge his conception, but we have the magical number 7. So once again, not J.K. Rowling, but here you have it from more scholarly perspective. Once again, the number 7 represent completion. The number 7 represents totality. The number 7 represents something that is cohesive. We went over 7 explanations. There are probably many more, but this is what we have for you today, 7 on 7. And maybe just to complete our discussion here, let's go to the Midrash, to Midrash Leviticus Rabbah, Vayikra Rabbah chapter, Parasha 29. 11, and it says, it's in Hebrew, but I will say it in English, all the sevenths are beloved forever. So it counts all kinds of 7 items, 7 things, and show that the 7th one is always the most favorite one. Lemala nashvi'i chaviv. So you have all the heavenly layers, if you want to call it this way, the cosmic layers, according to the Midrashic tradition, and the most dear one is the 7th one. Arakiyashvi, the 7th heaven. Among the nations, the 7th one is the dear one, and in some manuscripts, the 7th one, it talks about the land of Israel. Among the generations, the 7th one is beloved, and the 7th generations are Adam, Seth, Enosh, Canaan, Mahalalel, Yered, and Chanoch. And Chanoch is the beloved one because it says, Vayitaleh Chanoch et Elohim. Chanoch walked with God and then he disappeared because God took him. It says that Chanoch never really died, but he was taken by God. So among the generations, the most beloved one is Adam. And then among the ancestors, our fathers, the mothers don't appear in this Midrash. Maybe this is something for our generations to create. It says you have 7 generations, and the 7th one is the most beloved one. Who are these generations? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Levi, Kehat, Amram, and Moshe. And Moshe is the most beloved one because Moshe alai Elohim, Moshe ascended to God. Moshe spoke with God face to face. He had a special kind of relationship with God. And then it's, if we spoke about the ancestors, now we're talking about the children. Among the banim, among the children, among the actually sons, the 7th one is beloved, and it cites a verse from Chronicles, the first book of Chronicles, that says, David hu hashvi'i. David is the 7th one. Among the year, the 7th one is dear, because it says, v'hashvi'i tishmetena untashta. The 7th year is the sabbatical year. That's the beloved year. You shall let the world, the land rest. And among the Shmitim, among the sabbatical years, the 7th one is beloved because the Kiddashtem, et Shnat HaChamishim, you shall sanctify the Jubilee year, right? That's the 7th among the 7th. And then among the days of the week, Shvi'i Chaviv, that's obvious, Ve'ivarech Elohim et Yom HaShvi'i, God bless the 7th day. And among the month, the seventh month is beloved, as it is said, "Bachodesh Hashvi'i be'echad l'chodesh." That's from Leviticus 23. Just to remind us that the 7th month is what we call today. This is what we have today as the first month. This is the month of Tishrei, but according to the biblical counting, it's the 7th month, and this is a beloved month because it has so many festivals and special days in it. We have Rosh Hashanah, the New Year Day, which is not the name that you find in the Torah, but never mind. We have the Day of Atonement. We have Sukkot, the Tabernacle Festival, and we have Shmini Atzeret, the 8th day after Sukkot. And today we celebrate also Simchat Torah. So these are just a few ideas about why all the sevenths are always beloved and why the number seven plays an important role in our culture. And I hope this kind of opens us a window to consider and to think about the sabbatical year, the Shana Shvi'it, from a different angle. We mentioned the 7 days of creation. We mentioned the 7 days of the week. We mentioned the Shmita year, the seventh year. We mentioned the Jubilee, the seven times seven. And let us mention what Professor Rachel Elior from the Hebrew University teaches us. She says that all the Chagim, all the festival, concentrated on 7 months, from the month of what we call today Nisan, which is the first month, where we celebrate Pesach, all the way to Tishrei, what we call today Tishrei, the Torah didn't know this name, that's considered the seventh month. And she also said that there were basically seven festivals. Not all scholars agree with her counting, but I think it's interesting for us to see what she's saying. So the first festival is the Pesach, the Paschal celebration, which took place on the 14th of the month, of the first month in the twilight time. The second festival is Chag HaMatzot, the festival of unleavened bread, which is considered to be two separate Chagim. In ancient times, of course, today we celebrate it together. The third Moed, the third designated time, is the harvest of the Omer. And the fourth one is what we call today Shavuot, the festival of weeks. The fifth one is what we call today Rosh Hashanah, but the Torah doesn't know the name Rosh Hashanah. It calls it Shabbaton, Zichron Torah, the remembrance of blowing of the horn, or Yom Torah, the day of blowing of the horn. And the sixth festival is Yom HaKippurim, the Day of Atonement, or the 10th day of the 7th month. And the last festival is Chag HaSukkot, which takes place in the middle of the 7th month. That's according to Rachel Elior. But let's just take one step back. Time gives us orientation in a very confusing world. We see the sun rise and the sun sets, yeah? And we see the change of the seasons, although lately the seasons are playing tricks on us because we don't observe what are the commandments that we need to observe that have to do with the preservation of the land and taking good care of the earth that we dwell on. But so we can observe the change of time, but this is something that happens in nature. Every culture, maybe this is the human project to give signs in the time, to mark designated times, to mark designated moments in this endless flow of time. Or maybe time doesn't flow, maybe time stands and we're flowing within time. But that's a different question. So we have a day, and this is something that we see in nature. We have a week that is less visible in nature, as we said. We have the month that has to do with the lunar system. Yeah, there's not really much of a meaning of a lunar in the solar system, because what is a month in the solar system? Month is based in and of itself on the lunar system, yeah, and the world moon and month, and also menstruation, by the way, comes from the same Greek and Latin roots. And then we have the year. The year has meaning only in the solar system. Yeah, it's based on the sun. Then we have 365 point something days. It doesn't really have a lot of meaning to think about the year in terms of the moon, because the year in terms of the moon is a combination of 12 lunar months. So the year as we have it today is a combination of the lunar and the solar. This is at least how it works in the Jewish tradition. And then we have a larger cycle. Yeah, we spoke about the day, the week, the month, the year. We have a larger cycle, and this is the cycle we are dealing with here, and this is the seventh year. And this is not something that really is felt within nature, but people who deal with permacultures can explain us the need for letting the land, the earth, rest periodically. And the Torah is speaking about a pulse or a riffle, if you want to call it this way, of seventh year. And then we have a larger cycle, which is 49 years. So in a way, the Shemitah allows us to have better orientation in the world, to have better understanding of where we are, of who we are, of our relationship with people, right? Because I can always reflect back to the previous Shnat Shemitah. Where was I? What was I doing? With whom I was? What did I do for work? So it gives us another cycle to reflect upon our lives and upon the world we dwell in. Yeah. So that's another meaning of Shnat Shemitah for us. An opportunity to reflect on our existence in the world, in our existence in time and through time and by time and transcending time, maybe. I invite you to my website where you can see many videos and recordings and essays about this and about other topics. And thank you very much. Shalom miYerushalayim.
Try.